Well, hello everybody. Welcome back to the shop.
And the whole F-14 project. Last video, which I still haven't uploaded, now that I'm doing this on 2 days later or whatever it is, we showed you guys something. I forget what. I think it was inlet ducts and all that good stuff. Anyway, what I am doing now is I'm getting ready to lay up the overwing fairing hatches, which is how you'll install your engines and all that good stuff. Can't really see it. You might see a little black knot. There's one there. When I took the plugs out of these things, they're extremely difficult to get out because of the top of the fairing here, or the stiffeners, as they were called on the real airplane. So what I did to make that easier is I drilled some 1/8-inch holes through the mold, and then just took some non-hardening modeling clay, kind of like what you would use for your parting points and all that stuff, and just filled the holes with those. That way resin won't get in there. And my thought process is when I get ready to demold this thing, I just take an air compressor, put a spray nozzle or a blow gun, whatever you want to call it, in there, and then just shoot some air through it. It'll help dislodge those during the demolding process, or at least that's the hope of what it will do. Whether or not that'll work, won't know until we can try it. Anyway, I got my little mixture of spooge made up here that I'm putting in the corners down there, just to fill in that 90 degree angle since the cloth can get in there, and just see they're kind of mad as I like to get down in there. Vacuum bag won't make it through that corner with all the perforated plastic and the bleeder and the fuel coil and stuff. It won't get in there really well. It'll get in there, just not as much as you want. And I'm going to show you guys something a little bit different on this. And I'm not sure if Bob's done a video on it or not. For those who know composite ARF, you'll be familiar with it. It's called live hinging. Essentially, all you're doing is you're using the skin of the part to become your hinge. So that's where the term live hinge comes from. So I got the spooge in here. I'm just taking some carbon tow, and I'm just putting it in here on top of the spooge. Doing this just to kind of stiffen up that spooge area. Probably not necessary, but because of the issues I had getting it demolded, a little bit of carbon tow will help strengthen it a little bit, so I don't have to worry about these snapping or anything. This is just 12K carbon tow. It's nothing major like that 50K stuff I use on wing panels. Just for a little bit of extra peace of mind. I'm going to take what's left of that little bit of spooge I've got, and I'm going to fill in the weeding and the trailing edge portions of it, or the front and a half parts of these stiffeners. And a good glob of this stuff. So the whole live hinging thing, you're probably wondering what the heck am I going to do live hinging on this for. Like I said, this airplane is going to be very, very accurate, or at least that is my plan. So in order for it to be very, very accurate, there can't be a gap between the fuselage and the wing in any position, really. For those who are familiar with the F-14, you know the fuselage,
where the wing goes over it, has an airbag that inflates when the engines fire up, and it kind of creates an aerodynamic fairing that
has the air, so it allows the air to flow very smoothly from these fairings over to the aft edge of the fuselage. As far as I know, no other F-14 kit ever has had that fairing for that, those airbags. And on top of the airbags, there is the little pedals here on the back of these fairings actually move. They're actually hinged or spring-loaded to where they flex onto the wing and they stay on the wing. So they provide a very tight seal to the wing. Again, I don't think those have ever been done on a model F-14. Ever. And that's where the live hinging comes in. The airbag's something I'm gonna do at some point, but right now I'm not too concerned with it because it's a very difficult thing to work out, just because you don't have an engine driven pneumatic system, so it's gonna have to be driven by an onboard system, or they have to be constantly inflated, and then you just check them. And like I said, it's complicated on the real airplane, it's going to be complicated on this thing. But it's going to be an option, so if you don't want it, you don't have to use it. But I want to use it because it's scaled. I love the F-14, so if the real one had it, I want mine to have it. But that's just me. All right, now in these stiffeners, I'm just gonna run a layer of glass in here. And I'm just stuffing it down in there on top of that layer of spooge. And this is just so you get a really nice, strong fairing here, or stiffener, whatever you wanna call it. If anyone's in Florida and wants a really good deal on a ready to bind and fly 35% extra, I got a Hangar 9 Extra 260 with all JR servos, Spectrum, power safe receiver, and an SV, 100cc twin, ready to go for $1,650. Giving that thing away just about. The engine's a Chinese knockoff of a DA that was pre-DLE. It runs extremely well. And can't really complain about the airplane. Typically, I don't like extra 260s. All the ones I've flown in the past always tip stalled extremely badly. This one really has no bad habits. If it wasn't for needing money for this project for landing gear and turbines and all the other 6 billion things I need for this thing, I wouldn't sell that extra, but I could use the money. So away it goes, hopefully. Somebody can buy it. course, this piece of them, you may wonder the fit getting down in there without wrinkling on me. Whatever. So two layers of this. Once I get these in here, I'm gonna mix up some epoxy
and start slapping some more stuff on. I got some flat molds primed. They're ready to be laid up too. I got all the materials cut out for that. I just gotta run the tape on the flanges and get the bag material cut out, and then I can lay those up. So I'm gonna do these overwing fairings, get them in the bag, make sure the bag's not leaking too bad, then I'll probably pop in a video and do the pair of flaps or something. Up some goat juice. To work. I have down some epoxy in here. I left that piece of cloth there a little long towards the back, so when you fold this over, it helps hold it down onto the surface. Otherwise, what will happen is when you have it do these 90 degree corners like this, sometimes it doesn't make the 90 unless you put it on the bias, which I should have done, but I didn't because I was lazy. But unless you put it on the bias, and even the bias, it doesn't make the 90 perfectly. But what it does is it helps, that all that extra overhang helps hold it down. That's why I did it that way. If anyone has ever wondered. Epoxy and a brush, get down here in the stiffener area. And then since that's all down there really, really good, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a piece of carbon tow and I'm going to put it up here in the corner of the mold flange and the surface, or the part flange. The reason I'm doing that is because since it's a hatch, I want just a little bit of extra strength there, even with that, the Air-X. Not a lot, I just want a little bit of extra oomph here in these corners, because this one will be getting opened and closed and all that a lot more often than everything else. So a little extra help right here won't hurt. Now I'm going to take a piece of cloth that I have already cut. Put here in the thing. Just poke it into place. And then while that one soaks up some epoxy, I'm over here and do the exact same thing to the other one. Nice thing about working with two parts that are big but not too big. You can just go from one to the other, and by the time you're done with one, the other one will be ready, and just keep bouncing back and forth, back and forth. Still gotta work fairly quickly, but get stuff done a little quicker. Even quicker if I had two hands, had another person helping do this stuff. But not that lucky, so oh well. Fold that cloth over and then just stipple it into the epoxy so it sticks. Wondering what I mean by stipple, I mean just take the end of the brush and like dab at it. Poke it with the end of the brush, whatever you want to call it. What you do is you're forcing the cloth down into the epoxy or the epoxy into the cloth, however you want to look at it, causing it to soak it up a little quicker.
some more epoxy down here in the stiffeners. And take a piece of cloth. Throw it over all of it. First, put your carbon coat where you want it. See, told you guys, every time I make a video, I almost always forget something. Y'all are bad luck. Granted, it doesn't help a lot of this I'm doing, it's just kind of on the fly as far as, this should work. No, I don't know, maybe not. It's not easy work, that's for sure. The layup's easy part is figuring out how you're going to do it. That takes a little bit of time. Is that going to be strong enough? No, I don't know. And second guessing yourself all the time. Costs a lot of money for screw ups. Alright, now that we've got the carpet pillow in place, now you can put your cloth down. In the dry spots with a little bit extra cloth, or a little bit extra epoxy, I mean. Nice and wet here. Because the next thing after this is to put down the Aerex tip cores. Right after, these slots where the stiffeners are. Get that in here with just some Weinmann scissors. I just want to slot the cloth here. The length of it, that way they fall down there into the stiffener as well. I often ask myself why I picked such a difficult airplane to do. The only word that comes to my mind? Stupid. And overly ambitious, that's probably a good one too. Alright, take our Aerex. Epoxy on both sides. Let's take our first piece down. Again, you'll notice it doesn't go the full width. It's got slots in it for the stiffeners. I really wish I would have left those stiffeners off and just did resin cast of that. would make life a heck of a lot easier. Since that center section had a lot of resin on it, I'm just gonna put this piece down. Paint some resin here. Get some resin on the outer portion piece. Second over there. I got a couple pieces of carbon here. These are gonna go literally right here on the edge. That one will go there, and I'll leave it to soak up some epoxy. That one will go right there. Now, while that one does that, come over here and do the other thing to the other side. Now, with all the videos between me and Bob, there should be no one out there complaining about how much the composite are for a BBM or a Skymaster or, well, Chinese airplanes excluded. Anything made in the US that's composite, you shouldn't complain. You now see and know how much work is involved in getting this stuff done. A whole lot of time, a whole lot of energy. A lot of materials. The thing you all see, material wise, is it's not just fiberglass and core material and peel ply, gloves, mixing cups, scissor, rotary blades, leader material, brushes. That stuff adds up over time, guys. I bet you I spent over $100 in just gloves. Probably another $200 to $300 in brushes. Okay. A whole lot of money to get to just the point that you're right here, where you're able to start making parts. If you want to make a business of it, with employees, cool. Insurance, OSHA stuff, and yeah, it's just really no fun. I'm sure for these guys like BBM. Alright. That piece of air X here in the corners. Should get exactly where we want it. Up in the corner itself, that will help to push that carbon toe and the glass and all in the corner so you get a nice stiff edge with no imperfections. The other nice thing about using this core material, you can get it right there in that corner, suck it down, and it'll force that cloth into the corner. That one. And this a piece. your epoxy down here where the carbon is going to go. Once you do this for a while, you'll get to the hang of it to where you'll know exactly how much, well, pretty dang close how much epoxy and that you'll need for a certain layout. All right, we'll leave that carton there. Now there's great little wallpaper rollers. I'm gonna take that and I'm gonna roll this carbon into that epoxy and try to get it to soak it up a little bit more. And start peeling our wax paper carrier off the back of it. Carbon soaks up a lot of resin. The more resin it uses, the heavier it gets. So I've come to the conclusion that really, unless you're just doing some monstrous airplane or something that's going to have a ton of load on it, like my carrier spars, carbon over about 4.5 ounces a square yard is too heavy. Go find some, pay the extra money, get some 4 ounces or some 3.5 ounce stuff. Or even some 2 ounce. Unfortunately, when you get the really light stuff, it gets really expensive. But if you want to build light and build strong, you got to pay the money. It's more resin on this part, so it's getting a little difficult for me. Now I'll try to get the carrier thumb off. There we go. Put a little more resin on here. To the other side. A little epoxy. Now, live engine.
What am I talking about?
Basically, you do it two ways. Fuel ply, all you do is you just take a piece, you throw it in here, like so. You notice I haven't put the next layer of glass on because of this. So your fuel ply here, what you'll do
is when you're ready to hinge whatever you're doing, you just cut your part down to the fuel pod. You don't cut through the fuel pod, you cut up to it. And then the fuel pod, what happens is the fuel pod stays flexible because it doesn't really harden like fiberglass does. That's why you can peel it off. And then the fuel pod stays flexible. You can also use Kevlar, like a really, really lightweight Kevlar. By lightweight, I mean like sub 1 ounce or sub 2 ounce stuff. It's like 1.5, 1.75, something like that. You don't want to use anything really, really, really heavy, because then it kind of adds a big lump to it. That way the thicker the filament, the harder the hinge is. So you want to keep it kind of like everything else. So these little strips of fuel poly, as long as I don't cut through them, will give me the hinge material for these overwing fairing feathers, as I'll call them. That way, you can put some sort of spring mechanism or a rubber band or whatever on the inside here to help pull them down onto the wing panel, so there's no gap. All right, so there's that. That's all but one layer of glass on each one. So next thing I'm gonna do, another layer of glass. And this layer of glass, I'm gonna actually try and force down into the slots here. To make life difficult, I'm sure. But it will tie all of this together. You gotta make sure you're ready to force it down in there. Or the second one, you don't pull it out of that one. That's why you see me holding it in place. Well, that wasn't all that bad though, was it? That was quite painless actually. Now we just gotta hope these will come out of the mold. Like I said, the plugs were a pain. Matter of fact, when I took the plugs out, these stiffeners stayed in the mold and I had to dig them out with a screwdriver and a chisel. Hopefully I don't have quite that much of an issue this time. If I had that big of a problem, I probably won't get stiffeners or overwing fairing. It'll probably just be some destroyed chunks of fiberglass and foam and everything else under the sun that's in this thing. Up here in the second stiffener location. Notice the fuel pod is now sandwiched between carbon fiber, fiberglass,
It's sandwiched in there, so all you gotta do is just very lightly score this layer of the cloth, and then come in from the other side and score through the cloth and the couple layers of fiberglass cloth around the stiffener areas, and then that little bit of carbon, and then you just sit there and flex it, and you got yourself a hinge part. So that's my little scale detail that I've been planning on doing on this thing for quite a while. I've just been researching exactly how to do it. Alright. Just barely ran out of epoxy. I'm out now. Not enough to really do anything with. So I'm going to mix up a little bit more. That way, I'm going to get this thing done. Hope you guys are learning something, or something new. See, I told you in my last videos, I'm not going to show you, if I'm going to do a video, it's not going to be just me slapping epoxy. I'm going to try and do something a little bit different and informative. It's kind of a lot of time for me to spend on doing a video on stuff that Bob covers in such depth. Those who are eagerly awaiting the test flights and all that stuff to purchase one. One thing I am going to do for everybody who buys one of these things is all airplanes are going to be serialized. Like all the parts, everything. I'm going to keep track of who gets what, whatever. I'm going to keep track of component weights. That way when you ship it or when you receive it, you don't have to weigh it. It's already done. All that will be in a spreadsheet for you. And the biggest thing is every airplane is going to come with a build CD that's basically going to show all of the internal structures of every component before the molds are closed for that part. That way there will never be any concern or doubt about what's under that skin. It's really frustrating with some manufacturers how you really don't know what's going on. I mean, one day they're doing this, next day they're doing that, next day they're doing something completely different. And for those who are kind of stuck in that boat with whoever that does that, not pointing elbows, not naming names, I feel for you guys. You know, y'all are really in a rock and a hard place as far as getting your stuff done. And it shouldn't be that way. I mean, small hobby. The jet community is extremely small in itself. And news travels fast. It doesn't matter who you are. If you get screwed, it's a lot of money. I mean, people are going to sit there and they're going to voice their anger. We're all guilty. When we get screwed, we want to retaliate. Waste of time. It means well because you gotta look out after yourself. But at the same time,
sometimes you just gotta take a step back and think, is it really the best course of action? I'm not judging anybody for what they choose to do. It's your own, you are your own person, you are your own self. So what you choose to do is your own agenda, whatever. I'm saying sometimes you gotta all sit back, think, relax. Maybe hold off on pushing that post button or send an email. I know I've been angered, perturbed over the years for whatever reason about many things. A lot of times at work. And you sit there and type up that email, you write that post, you whatever. And you post it without even really thinking, because you're just angry and you want to just vent, and you need to vent, it makes you feel better, and then later on you kind of, you may or may not regret it. I know there have been many times where I've typed up an email to somebody and sat there like, you know, went and took a shower before I sent it, came back, sat down, read it, changed some things, which made it sound a little less, less rough, less emotional, I guess. And then went and did something else, went and had dinner, came back, sat down again. It's amazing how just even 12 hours of looking back on some situations, I was like, you know, I was mad. But why was I really mad? I'm like, yeah, it kind of sucked. Life is frustrating. But you just gotta get over it. You can't let the little things bother you too much. All right. Anyways, enough of my preaching. I know that's not what you guys want to hear. I'm gonna clean these gloves a little bit. So back to model airplanes instead of lectures from a 30-year-old. Anyways, what I do now is I'm just gonna run around the backside of this thing. I'm just gonna trim the cloth right up to the edge. I'm not gonna do completely to the edge. I'm gonna wait till pull it out of the bag when it's still green, and then I'll trim it and leave it out of the bag. And away we go. I just want to trim some of the excess, that way it doesn't wrap around and fold over and stick itself to the top portion of the top surface of the mold. Same thing up here on these flanged areas. I'm just going to trim away the excess. Some of the excess. I have yet to buy a set of those carpet shears or whatever that Bob has. The ones that had like the ductile on the side of it or whatever you should call it. Those are perfect for this, and I've just been too dang lazy to order them. Well, really, they're just been too cheap. $30 or whatever for the scissors. Yeah, I'm sure they're definitely worth the expense. I'm just too cheap to pay $30 for a pair of scissors. I don't even like paying $30 for surveys.
wondering when I'm going to close up the fuselage molds. Soon, I hope. Waiting on a couple checks to come through. That way, I can order my wing sweep actuators, because I need to design the mount structures for those before I can close up the fuselage. I could close it up beforehand and install it afterwards, but that would make things really difficult. So because I really don't feel like having to work really, really hard, and I'm not that big of a hurry, I'm not too concerned about closing it up. I know you guys are ready to see that thing. I am too. Just I'm kind of debating on if I want to close it now, even if I had all the actuators and all that stuff, or just wait until I get the landing gear, then close it up. That way all the gear structure, everything is installed at once. That way I'm not having to fight to install that stuff afterwards. Because if I install it before or after I close it up, all my little